presentation. To start, before introducing Vitali selectors, first of all, I want to introduce you to what we call a selector of a given family's offset. Here we have P, which is a partition of a given set, where we are taking gamma as some indexing set, which can be a finite set, infinite, countable, and so on. A subset S of X is said to be a Vitali selector, a selector of this family, if it contains just one element from each of these sets. Here, cardinality, I mean the number of elements between S and A alpha. And these should be free for each alpha. If we take a simple illustration, if we take this one as our whole set X, and these are the set A alphas, I mean this one is the composition of our set. Then by a selector, we mean this one, which just contain one element from any of these sets. So this is a picture which can be seen on Wikipedia. For example, also we can do the decomposition of the set of natural numbers by taking just subsets which are made by an even number and an odd number. And when you take just the set which contain even number, it will be a selector of this family of sets. Another point that I want to introduce you, which will be used through the presentation, is the axiom of choice. If we have a non-empty family of sets which are decisions, then this axiom says that it is possible to find a set S which contains exactly one element from any of this set, meaning that the cardinality of this intersection is equal to one. Also, here there is an illustration of the axiom of choice. If we take our set to be like this, you see, they are disjoint. This axiom says that it is possible to find a subset of the whole union just which contain one element from any of these set. So the most important selectors are known as Vitali selectors. Vitali selectors were introduced at this time by the Italian mathematician, and the construction is like this. Of course, it was improved later by other mathematicians, but Vitali was the one who introduced the starting point. The idea here is to take a countable dense subgroup of the additive topological group of Lie numbers. Here we are taking Lie numbers as a group under addition, but also we assume that it has the additional structure of being a topological space, where the topology under consideration is the Euclidean topology. So you can think of Q as the set of rational numbers. One can define a relation by saying that whenever you take any two Lie numbers, we say that they are in a relation if and only if the difference is an element of Q. Of course, since Q is a group under addition, one can see that the relation which is here is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive, meaning that it is an equivalent relation. But we know whenever we have an equivalence relation, we must have equivalence classes. So equivalence classes here are denoted in this way. This is the set of all equivalence classes. Here alpha is some indexing set. But also, as we know, whenever we have equivalence classes, we know that they decompose a given set. So that's why we have the layer line, which can be written as this, a union of equivalence classes. When we have a set A and we have an element T, we will write A plus T just to mean that A has been translated by T element. A plus T is the translation, is the translated set. So if you look to how this equivalence relation is defined, you can see that if we have an equivalence class which contains an element X, one can see that from the definition of our equivalence class, one can see that each equivalence class is just a translation of the subgroup Q. So since translation is a mapping which is bijective, it follows that each equivalence class is a countable set because Q also is countable. Also, since translation is a mapping which is homeomorphism, then each equivalence class also is a dense subset of R. If I come back, here we know that the Lie line was decomposed into two. This union, the set R is uncountable, but each equivalence class here is countable. And the two elements here are disjoint. That's why we must have the cardinality of the indexing set to be equal to C. The continuum. To understand, one can think of those subgroup, like for example, rational numbers, its extension by using the even numbers, its extension by using the rational numbers, and so on. Those are some examples of subgroup which can be used in the construction. Since each equivalence class is like a translation of a given element, here I have highlighted some examples of equivalence classes. In the case, for example, when we have our subgroup is the same as rational numbers. Each equivalence class of, for instance, square root of two, you take this one, you translate by square root of two, and so on. However, whenever you take an element which belongs to Q, its equivalence class, just you get this Q, because whenever you add the two rational numbers, you stay inside. By a Vitali selector, we mean any subset of the Lie numbers which contain just one element from each equivalence class. If we are able to enumerate all equivalence classes, for example, you can take the beginning element and you do it for all equivalence class, that one will be an example of a Vitali selector. You can even choose one, any other one. The condition is that just you have one element from each equivalence class. That's why here we will need the implication of the axiom of choice, which tells us any such set should exist. If we look to some properties of Vitali selectors, the first one is that if you take a Vitali selector, which is related to a given subgroup Q, I mean the subgroup Q is the one which was used in the construction, and you take two different elements, then this intersection is equal to empty. And from here, we can get another decomposition of the set of Lie numbers, which can be written as this countable union of this set. This decomposition is very important because it is a way of writing a set, way of writing the set of Lie number into a countable union of these set. This decomposition is actually used to prove the following important theorem, which says that each Vitali selector is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. So to prove this statement, we need just to use the previous decomposition. Another important lemma, important result about the Vitali selector is that whenever you take a Vitali selector, which is related to a countable dense subgroup of the additive group of real numbers, and you take this set, you translate it by a real number, again, you get a Vitali selector. It means that also the set that you get should be a non-measurable subset of R. The interesting research about Vitali selectors is about union of Vitali selectors. This theorem says that if each element in this family is a Vitali selector related to the subgroup Q, it means that Q is the one which is used to construct this set, then this union is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. One can see the proof in this book. Here we have an example of sets which are not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. But when you go to, if you go in the literature, you will find some other kinds of set which are not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. Of course, here we are interested in Vitali selectors. We can go to the problem under investigation since we have some notion related to Vitali selectors. So because we know that there exist non-measurable set and the measurable set, now if we take our collection of all subset of R, if we denote it like PR, then we can decompose it into two disjoint families. The first one is the family of all measurable set. The other one is its complement, which is made by set which are not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. If I start from the first one, the family of Lebesgue measurable set, here its structure, its algebraic structure, of course, in the set theoretic point of view is well known. Everyone knows that this family is a sigma algebra of set, meaning that it is closed under countable union, countable intersection, and some other properties. Also, it contains the collection of all Borel sets, but also it contains this collection of nil set. Another important property of this family, to get it, we first introduce this definition. If you have a family of set and you have a group of homeomorphism, this family of set is said to be invariant under action of this group if whenever you take any set in this family and you take any homeomorphism of R into itself, then the image of this set under this mapping is also in the family F. So one can see that if we can consider the group of all translations of R into itself, we know that Lebesgue measurable sets are invariant under the action of this group. This is what we usually say, that the translated image of a measurable set also is a measurable. Is a measurable set. Actually, they have even the same measures. However, if we go in the literature, we can find some homeomorphism which do not preserve the Lebesgue measurability. It means that you can have a measurable set and a mapping which is homeomorphism. You apply the mapping to that set, and that is the resulting set is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. If I go to the other family, the family of set which are not measurable in the Lebesgue sense, it doesn't have a well-defined structure. This means that you can have a union or intersection and so on of two non-measurable sets, but the resulting set can be a measurable set or a non-measurable set. So that's why we are saying that the union, respectively the intersection of two elements from A to C can be inside or outside. In particular, as one can observe, such a family cannot be a sigma algebra. However, this family is also invariant under the action of this group, meaning that when you translate also a non-measurable set, you get, again, a non-measurable set. However, like the case of measurable set, there exists some homeomorphism which do not preserve the non-Lebesgue measurability. You remember at the beginning, we defined what we call Vitali selectors related to a given countable dense subgroup. So now if Q is a countable dense subgroup of this additive group, we denote by view Q the family of all Vitali selectors associated to Q. So now the question under investigation, we are trying to look if we can find subfamilies of PR which have some algebraic structure in the set theoretic point of view, and of course, which are not measurable in the Lebesgue sense, but starting from Vitali selectors. If I say in the other word, we want to find algebraic structure in the non-Lebesgue measurable set, but starting from Vitali selectors. That is the problem that we are investigating now. To suggest some answers to this problem, we will need to introduce some technical concept. The first thing to introduce here is the concept of a semigroup of set. Of course, a semigroup can be defined in the way that we know in the algebra, but our this definition also coincide with the definition that we know when we take our binary operation to be the union of set. Here, we are saying that a given non-empty collection of set is said to be a semigroup of set if this family is closed under finite union of set. It means that whenever you take two element A and B, we must have the union A union B in S. Another concept which is known in set theory that I want to recall you is the concept of an ideal of set. A non-empty collection of set is said to be an ideal of set. First of all, if it is closed under finite union of set, and if it is closed under taking subset, it means that if you take A in I and B, which is a sub, and B is a subset of A, then necessarily we must have B, which is also in I. If in addition, our idea of set is closed and countable unions of set, then you know that it is called a sigma idea of set. Here are some examples. If you take, for instance, the family of all finite subset, one can see that this one satisfies all conditions of being an idea of set. This one is an idea of set. The collection of countable sets, the sigma idea of set, all of them, they are the semi group of set because they are closed under finite union of set. The same is true when we take the collection of all subsets of R having the big measure zero. We know this collection is a sigma idea of set. Here, this one will be used in the following slide. If you have a family of set, and then you introduce this new family by taking all possible finite unions of elements in A. Here N is the set of natural numbers. So one can see that whenever you take any element here, I mean, whenever you take a two element here, you do the union of these two elements.
Excuse me?
Yes?
The definition of ideal of sets. So J is an ideal if it is a semigroup, and O, and if A is in J, then all the subset of A is in J, is in, yes. Is in as yes. Well.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Semigroup means that whenever you take a two element A and B in I, the union should be also in I.
Yes, and this is the definition of, okay.
Yeah, this is the definition. Of course, here okay. We have the replace some usual condition by saying that I is first of all a semi group, and then we add this. Okay.
Yeah, can we let the presenter complete down your questions? You ask them at the end. Thank you very much.
Okay, good. This family will be used a lot. I mean, we have a family of set, and then we consider all possible, the collection of all possible union of each element. One can see that whenever you take an element of this form, you take another element of this form, because the union of, is fine. I mean, we are taking finite union, the union of two elements will be, again, an element of SA. Here, there is another point which is very important in the following slide. It's a way which can be used to increase a given semigroup of set whenever you have an idea of set. If A and B are families of subset of R, one can define another family by introducing this operation A star B. We are taking an element A from A minus an element B from B, then a union an element B from B. This operation helps us to extend a given semigroup of set by using an idea of set. So if S is a semigroup of set, I is an idea of set, you remember the definition, then these two families, I star S and S star I, are also semigroups of set for which these two inclusions are but this semi group also is a subset of this one. Moreover, because this one is a big semi group of set, one can ask if we can again increase this semi group of set just by again applying the same operation. Unfortunately, if we apply the same operation to the same idea, we don't get anything new, meaning that this operation has to be applied once. So that's why we have those two equalities. So this proposition gives us a way to increase a given semigroup of set by using idea of set. So now we are going to apply this theory, especially this proposition, to Vitali selectors of the Lie line. You remember that we have seen that there exist different countable dense subgroups of the additive group of Lie numbers. So when we have a countable dense subgroup, you remember that we can define Vitali selectors. So Vitali selectors associated to a subgroup Q, we are denoting them like this. I mean, it's the family of such set. Here, now we take the collection of all possible finite union of Vitali selectors related to what? To VQ. Here, as you can see, following the previous example, this family is closed under finite union of set. If you have a set of this form and another set of this form, you do the union, you stay inside. Okay. I recall you again this theorem, which was saying that whenever you take a non-empty finite family of Vitali selectors, which are related to the same countable dense subgroup, this finite union is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. So now, using this theorem and the previous proposition, we can have the following theorem, which give us some families of set which have an algebraic structure of being semigroups of set and for which each element is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. So the theorem says that these three families, V1Q, you remember that is the collection of all possible finite union of Vitali set. Now, if you take this one is a semigroup, then we extend it by using the sigma ideal of nil subset, we get again semigroup of set for which these two proper inclusions are satisfied. The good point is that each element here is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. The other point is that whenever you translate an element here, again, you get an element here. It means that this family is invariant under the action of the group of all translation of R. So this was a first result which was giving us structure in families of set without the Bell property. But this was proved in a couple of years ago. Here, the point is that we are looking finite union of Vitali selectors related to the same countable dense subgroup. And now one can ask what will happen if, for instance, V1 is a Vitali selector which is related to one subgroup, V2 is a Vitali selector which is related to another subgroup, and so on. And then we consider the union of Vitali selectors which are related to different countable dense subgroups. In this slide, that is what we are saying, that the previous theorem was proved for Vitali selectors related to the same countable dense subgroup. But one of the main results of this presentation is when we take a finite union of Vitali selectors which are not necessarily related to the same countable dense subgroup. It means that you use one countable dense subgroup, you construct Vitali selector, another one, use another subgroup, and we take a finite union of some of them. So this says that any finite union of Vitali selectors which are related to, I mean, where each VI is a Vitali selector related to a given countable dense subgroup, then this set is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. What I have to point out here is that if all QI are the same, then we come back to the this one. Here all are related to one subgroup. So now with this theorem, we can have a more we can have a more important result, which is the second result of this presentation. The idea, instead now of taking Vitali selectors related to one countable dense subgroup, just we take now Vitali selectors related to any subgroup and we put them together. You remember that C is the collection of all countable dense subgroup. So if we have this family, then we can consider the collection of all finite union of element of this family. Of course, this family is closed under finite union of set. That's why it is a semigroup of set. And of course, when you take one subgroup, it is evident that these inclusions are satisfied. Then using the proposition that we have seen and this theorem, then we can have the main result, which is saying as each of these two families are semigroups of set for which elements are non-measurable in the Lebesgue sense. These two inclusions are satisfied, and each element here is invariant under translation. This one is a more general result because each of, for example, this one contain this one, because this one was stated just for one subgroup. Here is just for all. So before ending my presentation, what we have been investigating in this theorem, I mean in this presentation, is just the algebraic structure in non-measurable Lebesgue sense, just starting from Vitali selectors of the Lio line. The main result of this presentation is that any union of Vitali selectors related to different countable dense subgroup is not is a non-measurable set in the Lebesgue sense. And this theorem, which is here, is giving some families with algebraic structure of being semigroups and also being invariant under translation. And each element here is not measurable in the Lebesgue sense. Those are the two important points that I wanted to share with you today. Of course, there are some others related to set with the Bell property that you have seen in the abstract. Bell property is also a topological concept, but if you want, the idea is almost the same with some modification. If you want, you can say that these family are semigroups of set satisfying this condition, invariant under translation, and each element doesn't have the Bell property. But I haven't defined the Bell property in this presentation. I will do it for the next time. Here are some references which have been used to prepare this presentation. I would like to say thank you for your kind attention.